In this video, Lyn Swackhamer, Director of Evaluation for NCWIT Aspirations and Computing Programs, walks through a sample evaluation.
For this next section, we are going to walk through evaluating a fictitious program. Let's pretend that I developed an after-school program for high schoolers who come from schools with a high percentage of free and reduced lunch students. My goal is to teach them some computing skills in order to spark their interest in a computer science major, and then hopefully into a career in computing. Let's say that I've been running the program for 2 years, and it seems to be successful and appears to be making an impact on the young people who participate. A local company, or perhaps my boss if I'm in industry, approaches me and discusses providing funding that would allow me to expand the program to reach even more young people. But first they want to know if I can show them some evidence that the program is working. What do I do now? I know I need to evaluate the program to get results to show what is happening, but what are my first steps? The first thing I should do is develop evaluation questions to guide the evaluation. What are some potential evaluation questions for this scenario? In general, with every project, we probably all want to know, what is the impact of the program on the participants? And did impact differ for different types of participants? So what is impact? How should we define it for this evaluation? Some examples include enjoyment, computer science skills, interest in continuing to take computer science courses, wanting to come back to your program, understanding what it means to do computing as a career, feeling like they belong in computing, or something else. For this scenario, I'm going to define impact as interest in computing and confidence in computing. So I want to find out if the participants' interest in computing and confidence in computing changed for the positive after attending my program. To do that, I need to find a survey instrument that is designed to measure interest and confidence. It is much better to try and find something already created than try to create your own instrument. One place you can go to look at instruments is ncwit.org/evaluation. Here you can find a selection of vetted instruments that you can use all or parts of to create your own instrument. Once you've identified your evaluation instrument, have someone from your target group take it and let you know how they are interpreting each item to be sure it's coming across appropriately. When you're satisfied with the instrument, next you would want to use it in a small group. Know that these data may or may not be useful since you're testing and piloting the instrument. Even if you have to use or report these data, think of it as a pilot so you watch for revision opportunities. Now your survey is ready to use on the entire group. Make sure that you assign someone to administer the survey and collect the data. Note that in some cases, a survey may not be the best way to gather your data. If that is the case, you can use interviews, observations, and/or authentic assessments to learn how the program is doing. Back to our scenario. So I've administered my pre-survey and post-survey and collected all of them. I've also matched each pre-survey with the same person's post-survey. This is a very important step. Any unmatched pre- and post-surveys cannot be used when conducting statistical analyses to measure change over time. When I match the surveys, I give each survey a unique ID number. I also record the ID number and who the ID belongs to, so I have that information if needed. But from here on, each survey is simply an ID number. This helps eliminate bias when analyzing the data. So what do I do now? How do I make it easy to analyze and interpret my data? First thing we have to do is to develop a code book that will help me change the survey answers into a form that allows me to conduct analysis. One easy way to do that is to make a copy of the survey and simply write the codes under the survey. For example, let's say that my survey had 5 items that were designed to measure interest in computing. Each person was asked to rate the items on a Likert scale from very interested, a little interested, and not at all interested. For these types of response categories, in order to use any kind of quantitative analyses, we must convert the categories into numbers. Typically, we number the most positive category with the highest number. So very interested becomes a 4, interested a 3, a little interested a 2, and not at all interested a 1. Next, we would want to enter the data into a spreadsheet program, such as Excel or Google Sheets. These programs allow you to use multiple tabs within a worksheet. We can keep everything in one place. For these next slides, please open the Google Sheet labeled Example Dataset. The first thing I would do is enter the codebook into the first spreadsheet tab so it is always connected with the data. Please look at the tab labeled Codebook. I would then enter the data into a different tab in the spreadsheet. In the example data set, I have multiple tabs for ease of demonstration, so do not let this distract you. On the tab labeled Data 1, you will see that each item in the survey would become its own column. The very first column in the spreadsheet would be for the individual survey ID number. The next columns would be for each item. In the tab labeled Data 2, you will see that each row is an individual survey. And in the tab labeled Raw Data, you see that I took each survey and entered the ratings from 1 to 4 for each item. You also see that I have columns for the matched post survey, and each pre or post survey item is clearly labeled as being pre or post. The ratings are entered into the same row as the matched pre-survey items. Once I have all my data entered into the spreadsheet, the next step is to analyze the data. Remember that if you are uncomfortable analyzing your own data, you can most likely find a social scientist colleague or hire a grad student from one of the social sciences to assist you. But with a little help from Google, you can conduct many simple statistical analyses right in Excel or Google Sheets. If you look at the tab labeled Analyzed, you see that I easily create overall item sums, mean scores, and standard deviations. If the items are designed to measure an overall construct, such as in my hypothetical example, you sum the scores for each unique ID and create an overall mean pre-survey and post-survey score for each individual. As you can see on the tab labeled t-test, with these overall mean scores, you can conduct a paired samples t-test analysis that will tell you if your mean scores for the pre-survey were statistically significantly different from your post-survey mean scores. Finally, while I haven't done that here, if you have a sufficient number of cases, you would want to disaggregate by gender and race to make sure your program is not inadvertently working for some populations and not others. You just need to remember to collect this information on the survey and enter it into the data set. After you analyze the data, you need to interpret any differences and explore if the data is showing an impact. First, you would look at the individual items and their differences over time. Which items had the biggest differences? Which items had the smallest differences? What are some ways that could explain those differences? The most meaningful interpretation in the differences is the overall mean scores from pre-survey to post-survey and in the differential analyses you conducted on gender and race. Hopefully, your testing showed that your program made a positive impact on your participants and you can obtain that promised funding.